Hello and welcome back to another Digging the Game. In this series, we play computer games as archaeologists. Now, you may initially be going, why? What's the point of that? Well, there are a few different reasons, I think. First of all, yes, undeniably, it's fun. I'm wearing my Link hat, crocheted for me by the lovely Mrs. Soup, so yes, today I'm going to be having some fun. But beyond that, actually, computer games are cultural artifacts. They are produced by cultures. They represent cultural perspectives and worldviews. They often have, internally, within the game itself, a universe that has its own history. And all of this stuff and how it's presented to you can be very revealing. Not only can you interpret something about, for example, how people assume, for example, an archaeological world will unfold, and this game today is certainly good for that, but also as well, you can sort of, in a reflective way, think about how archaeology is applied to spaces in a fairly neutral way. You're not applying archaeology to a real-world site, you're applying it to a digital site, and therefore actually the theory itself, the archaeology itself, has an opportunity to be questioned and tested, and you sort of think, well, does this actually work in realms that are unfamiliar to us in the real world? So there are various reasons to play computer games as archaeologists, and I know some of you are simply will never be convinced of that, and so this video isn't for you. But for those of you who are interested, for those of you, for example, who are fans of Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, today is going to be a bit of fun. Now, we're starting out in the Shrine of Resurrection, which is basically where the game starts. And the first time, if you were lucky enough to play this game, the first time you played it, you would run up this hillside here and get a good look at the vista. And one of the great things about this particular game is that it is what's called open air. It's not an open world game. Nintendo have coined the phrase open air to describe the world because it is very much a living, breathing space. It looks and feels like a Hayao Miyazaki animation. It has some remarkable gameplay mechanics in terms of, for example, how creatures and the weather and all sorts of other things, sound and temperature, interact with how you play the game. And a facet of this is, in fact, the archaeology. And this was actually one of the first things I did when I first played this game, was I ran down this hill and I ran straight towards that building over there. Now that is the Temple of Time. And the Temple of Time is very important. In the mythology of the Legend of Zelda games, it really first prominently turns up in the Ocarina of Time, which is the N64 classic. And even before this game came out, I was very much aware that actually what they'd done in creating this game was they had referenced, obviously, the previous Zelda game, but in referencing it from a future perspective, they had essentially created an archaeological site. And so when you actually compare the outside of the building of the Temple of Time to the N64 counterpart, yes, okay, it's clear, for example, graphically, the two just don't stand up to one another. But nonetheless, it is also clear that this is an interpretation of where that building, if it was real, or indeed not even if it was real, in the game world, where that building has ended up. Now, This as an archaeological site is 100 years on from a great calamity, and we have here these robots, these monsters, which have been attacking the site. So I have to deal with this chap here. There we go. These robots have been attacking the site. They're called guardians, and they've been frozen in place by a force which I shall not spoil, but something nonetheless halted their attack on the temple. But as you can see, they're fairly large. Moss is now growing on them, but they also came extremely close to wrecking the place. And this is one of the first things which really, I think, impressed me, frankly, when I first started playing this game, was the way in which they have portrayed a ruined building. These days it's increasingly common to have complex textures and, for example, ruins in computer games. But this one is particularly, I think, sensual. It is lovingly crafted, from the broken glass in the mullion windows there, to the stonework where the masonry is coming apart, and even, and this is what really got my geekiness excited, even the different layers of the roof here. So we have a lead underlayer, you have a wooden superstructure, or the A-frames on which the roof is sitting, and then you have the slates, or the, are they slates? Oh no, so you have a lead outer layer as well, with tiles running along the top. This is very much an archaeological site, and it's frankly, this is the sort of thing that you cannot do in the real world. You cannot, for example, just climb up the ruins of a monastery. I would argue that actually this particular type of archaeology, or rather the site that's being portrayed here, also represents I suppose a phase of archaeological sites that rarely gets to really mature in a natural way. I suppose what I'm getting at is that rarely do societies actually tolerate buildings just being in ruins like this. Usually this stuff would be either turned into a farmer's field, as for example at places like Fountains Abbey historically, you know, the land was given over to other purposes, or the site would be flattened and it would be repurposed, it would be basically redeveloped. What we're looking at here is, I suppose, is the equivalent of the post-Roman world, for example, in Britain. It's the world where things are falling apart, and where even for example the organic elements, such as there are places where there are tables and beds and bookshelves, you know, still just about standing in these ruins. So it's a textured archaeological presentation, I guess. And so as I was first playing this game, I was loving that. As much as I love Zelda, I was also in particular loving the fact that you can start to interpret the space. So here we have, for example, a fountain area with a courtyard below. The courtyard cobbles obviously have seen better days in the past, but that's identifiable. And presumably this would have been a processional way leading up to the Temple of Time. Now what intrigues me, and again one of the first things I was thinking when I was playing this game, was what are these buildings that are off to the right and to the left? They're below the Temple of Time up there, and each of them seems to have a sort of an altar-like space. So steps leading up to an altar-like space, and they also they seem to be providing a function that's sort of what we might call liminal in the archaeological world, essentially a sort of transitional space. Because actually, you can't walk straight up to the Temple of Time from these steps here. You have to, for example, turn right and go in there, or you have to turn left, come up here, and find yourself in another similar building here. Once again with steps and an altar-like space at the back. And I think this is possibly where the public are allowed access to. So in a castle or in an area such as, for example, a temple, like a great temple, say, in Jerusalem, historically, yeah, there are spaces that you just weren't and aren't allowed to go into. And so presumably, the higher up these steps you get, and the more you go beyond certain buildings and certain, I suppose, cultural checkpoints, whether you're literally being stopped or whether you're just expected to stop at certain points, there are different areas that seem to be filtering, sieving out, I guess, access. So here's another area. So this is, I suppose, stage three. So if you're sort of stage three importance, you can get this close to the Temple of Time. You're within the shadow of it, but still, presumably, you might make an offering, for example, in there, and then go away. And if you're super special, you get to climb the steps all the way to the top and access the temple itself. Now, these sorts of ideas are expressed, as I say, in castles and in city planning, and in something as simple as, for example, I've talked in a previous video about how you can analyze access within a castle, for example, and privacy. So the number of doors you have to go through to get to a certain room is really is a important marker of its cultural use, privacy, access, and therefore, so I suppose, privilege. So, for example, in the video where I talked about this previously, I used Conwy Castle as an example. And in that example, the room you had to get, the room which had the most number of doors between the outside and accessing the room was actually the king's private toilet. So these ideas in terms of access, in terms of the stages that you have to get through to pass, from outside to inside, these are very important ideas. And we've sort of touched on this previously in terms of the phenomenology of Skyrim. And I think in a more literal sense, in a more sort of, I suppose, town planning kind of sense, it's been applied quite elegantly here in terms of the Temple of Time. But if we continue down the steps, this presumably again was some sort of processual way, very wide steps. It can probably accommodate whole crowds of people, throngs of people coming down these steps. And historically, it seems they passed between pillars that are now collapsed and then out onto a sort of another sort of staging area. Once again, the Temple of Time is in the distance. It is the highest and most prominent thing that you can see from this space when you're in this sort of this cobbled area. So again, so probably some sort of gathering place. And this might be where maybe the lowest of the low had to wait while other people made the procession up to the I suppose those different chapels, I suppose, further up. But then if we continue down, now sadly because of the great calamity, it gets a bit complicated to interpret this stuff. But you can see these robots, these guardians, have been trying to climb their way up. They're all trying to make their way up the hill. And it seems that despite this area now being flooded, this was once an access point that led down off what is now a sort of a plateau area. So we can see the water gets deeper and deeper. So presumably historically you could walk up or rather down, I suppose, and get onto the flat land below. Sadly, I haven't yet got a way to dive, so I can't do an underwater survey over there, but I can show you what is beyond. Now, so here we have, once again, an important idea in archaeological analysis is the things that gain your attention. And so almost pretty sure at no other point on this sort of curtain wall do we have these eagle-like structures. So again, sort of highlighting that this was an access point and people would walk from down there. Walk from down there, which is now flooded. Flooded behind, but now sort of very much blocked by earth, and they would make their way up a steep hill onto the plateau and then to the Temple of Time beyond. It's very well thought out. And this is the next stage of this notion of playing computer games as an archaeologist, is that you have to appreciate and acknowledge the fact that this is a designed world. And so in many ways this reflects how the game designers imagine a space would age over the course of around 100 years. Here at the bottom of the plateau, outside this sort of the lowest level of access, we start to get, more mundane buildings. They're less like chapels, much more like storehouses, warehouses, and eventually dwellings as well. And these two people here, actually, these are looters. They're looking for... Yeah, whatever treasure is to be had belongs to us, so don't go poking around, says Mills. So these guys are out here looting what looks like must have been some sort of storage area. So you just deal with this chap. Okay, that's that guy dealt with. Pick up his bananas that he left behind. And this mystery sword, Wind Cleaver. Okay. Now, actually, in terms of the items and the artifacts and weapons in the game, that is something which is quite cool. Is that you have lots of objects that are, you know, they've seen better days. They're rusting. Lots of weapons, for example, that you find in the buildings around the bottom of this plateau area are in a state of disrepair. Sometimes you might come across rusty shields, rusty swords, so on and so forth. And I suppose in this way, it's quite, you know, refreshing to, again, yet you see artifacts and objects that have been subject to the rusty shield there, subject to the ravages of time. So as I was saying before we were so rudely interrupted, once again we're shown the ways in which the game developers, I suppose, presume, but also presumably as well with a certain amount of research, the ways in which they are suggesting that this material has survived and lasted over the course of the past century or so. We have, for example, hanging banners, which again I think really highlights this notion that up there, where the Temple of Time was once an area that people would process to, that they would come to maybe once or twice a year for grand special events. It's really telling a story, but beyond telling a story as well. I suppose archaeologically, I would criticise this idea of those banners lasting 100 years. I'm not sure that they would last outside for 100 years, but this is where the element of game design, I guess, comes in. There is this is an artistically created world, as much as it is anything else. Now, there are various videos I could make in this world. There are various sites that I could visit. There's a couple of places in terms of the alignment of buildings, which I think are very interesting. There's the way in which you're encouraged to explore the world in a anthropologically very sound way. You sort of learn the world through a series of stories. So, for example, there, the mountains in the distance, those are the dueling peaks, and you sort of navigate the world through these stories and your associations with them. So I'd be more than happy to make more videos along these lines. If you're interested, please do comment below. But today, like I said, I'm really focusing on this, on the ruins around the plateau in particular. So here we have someone's bed and a carpet left below. Now, I think what's interesting about the bed construction is that it is unconventional. It is basically a flat board bed. I wonder if there are some real world comparisons we could make there, in so much as I suppose most beds that I'm familiar with have slats instead of a board. And here we have a dining table, lots of pottery left on the floor. Clearly this calamity was sudden and quite quick. You don't, for example, just leave crockery on a dining table unless you're having to run out of the building quite quickly. But I think that's the speed of what happened is fairly evident, again, just from the fact that you have these ruins. So here we have, again, a dining table, a rusty claymore, another bed, a bookshelf there, and then we have these guys, the guardians, again, tearing the place apart. Literally, in this case, tearing the fountain apart. So I think the archaeology tells a compelling story, a compelling and clear story that clearly things went wrong, and people found themselves in a very dangerous situation, which is also, I think, a fairly emotional story as well. There's something quite beautiful about the way in which this game has portrayed the natural processes of decay. It is beautiful. It's inevitable and beautiful. Anyway, there's one more thing that I'd like to try and show in this video. And let's see if I shall beam over to here. Okay, so Kaowan Shrine, or Kaowan Shrine. I want to head over here. So as I was saying at the beginning of the video, the one of the most amazing and wonderful things about this game is the sense of nature and the sense of the world. And so when you're actually exploring the place, it's very easy to get distracted. It's not a series of discrete pockets of activity. The whole place is rustling and hopping with, you know, there's a fox hopping with life, and I very much appreciate that. And just from I suppose briefly from a gamer perspective, from a perspective of as a computer game player, I think this is probably one of the best games I've ever played. Stand on the rock and see if I can see anything, okay. Now I think, yes, I want to head over there. But I'm a little bit concerned too, and you may or may not see why I'm concerned to head over there in a moment. Tara, let's speed things up a little bit, shall we? So, here we are on the outskirts of what I wanted to just quickly examine. And looking around, I can't see any danger. You see, the guardians around here, the robots, are very much still active. So, I don't want to get their attention because they're quite dangerous. Oh, there's one. Oh, rats. There is one. Well, there you go. I was hoping not to bump into one of those guardians, but I think we did okay. But anyway, the thing I wanted to show you while we're over here, oh, I'll just pick up these guys as well. Yeah, were these ruins. And these are very special ruins. These are actually ruins, as I was saying at the beginning, the Temple of Time is very much inspired by the Ocarina of Time, the Zelda game. Well, this is an area that's actually directly from that game as well. It's the Lon Lon Ranch Ruins. I'll just deal with that guy. Yep. These are the Lon Lon Ranch ruins, and For people who are familiar with the Ocarina of Time, this is the place where we first got Epona in that game, like 20 odd years ago now, I guess. This is the entrance to the land, to the ranch. We have the track that you run around. This is the race track. It's quite a large space, and here's the ruins of the tower in the back. And this, I think I'll end on this note really, just for today, is the fact that this really highlights this third idea beyond, I suppose, the archaeology that I can appreciate as an archaeologist, and beyond the ideas of decay that the game developers may be trying to build into their game world. What we're now seeing, because of the longevity of computer games as an entertainment format, and because of how long people have been playing these games, what we're now seeing is the fact that, well, we're able to portray the ruin of spaces. We're able to show them in their prime, and then maybe a few years later, they're revisited as a ruin. And I think there's something really beautiful about that. You know, there are computer game characters now who we've seen go through entire lifetimes. For example, Ezio Auditore da Firenze, an assassin in the Assassin's Creed games, who we've seen go from, you know, being a lusty teenager all the way to being an old man and finally dying in the format of computer games. And so increasingly, I think computer games are reflecting life, and life is archaeology. And the very fact that we have here the ruins of a site first seen and first visited back in 1996, 1997, in the shape of Lon Lon Ranch, I think is quite evocative. So I think we'll leave it there for now. But I think, as I say, you can't really dismiss computer games anymore as a reflection of all these different facets, and also an environment in which to express and explore them. And I think The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild is a really, really interesting forum in which to start tackling some of these ideas, and also for me to start to show some of these ideas. And for archaeologists, I think, to test ideas and to check that their ideas hold water. So as I say, I could make a whole mini-series on this game world. Today I've just been showing you very obvious ruins. Archaeology, I suppose, in its purest form, ruins. But also ruins actually in a whole phase of ruin that we don't tend to see as archaeologists. These ruins tend to get either replaced by newer buildings, or they tend to in the case of, for example, castles, they've been through this phase long ago. So yeah, that's what I've been looking at today. But there are other things that we can examine, and I would like to maybe examine that with you. So let me know below what you think, and hopefully this has been fun and or interesting. As ever, until next time, do take care. Bye bye.